Hello everybody and welcome to video number 24 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are in chapter 4, particle trajectories, and in the last video we talked about particle trajectories in a stellarator field. And in this video we will talk about the influence of a radial electric field on the trajectories both in tokamak and stellarator. So we will talk about the influence of radial electric field. Now, a radial electric field, and you might not be surprised by that, induces drifts on a flux surface. You know, you have the E cross B drift, so every time when you have an electric field and a magnetic field, which we always have a magnetic field in a toroidal confinement experiment, this electric field induces drift. So a radial electric field now induces drifts on the flux surface. And a radial electric field can, for example, be created, as we will see, by fast losses of electrons as compared to ions. So if you have initially more electron losses than ions, then a radial electric field builds up, and we will discuss that in one of the next videos. But for now, we just discuss the influence of such a radial electric field. So if we have toroidal symmetry, like in a tokamak, so at toroidal symmetry, then the toroidal drift component is not of interest. Then the toroidal drift component is not of interest. However, there is also a poloidal drift component. There's also a poloidal drift component, as we have tilted magnetic field, as you know. So there's a poloidal drift component, and this can induce, or rather influence, the particle trajectories strongly. Yeah, so it's the poloidal drift component we are looking at. So it's a D for drift, and then theta, the poloidal component that is given by the radial electric field over B phi, so the toroidal magnetic field. Okay, let's try to explain that with a drawing. So again, we try to draw a poloidal cross section. For example, like this. And then elongate it into this direction. Elongate it into this direction. Then here we have the center somewhere. Then going down here is that's the radial coordinate. And then we have particle sitting somewhere here, which moves along a magnetic, if the corresponding magnetic field line then looks like this, right, going around the torus here. So this is B, the magnetic field line. And then the particle here has a parallel component. A parallel velocity component, V parallel, which is, as you can see, hopefully along the magnetic field line. And it has also, assuming now we have a radial electric field, so something which points somewhere to the center. So this continues here. So this is a radial electric field. And now E cross B leads to a drift component which is in this coordinate system pointing downwards. So it has a drift component pointing downwards, and of course it also has a poloidal velocity component pointing upwards. So if we were to project this to this area here, to this poloidal cross section, then we have a velocity component here pointing upwards of the particle itself. So this is v theta, the particle's velocity component, and then we also have a velocity component, a vector pointing downwards, and this is the drift of the induced drift, the poloidal drift component of the E cross B drift from the radial electric field. Yeah, so as a reminder, U d theta is given by the radial electric field over the toroidal magnetic field. And as you might have already guessed, a critical situation arises if the drift, the polar drift component, cancels out the thermal motion component, the particle's thermal motion component v theta, that would correspond to v theta being v parallel over b theta over b, well, b parallel, so this is just rearrange the equation where you can write v theta over v parallel is equal to b theta over b parallel, and b parallel is b phi. So here we have then b getting then this equation. And again, as a reminder, b theta is much smaller than b phi, just as a reminder. Yeah, so this is our typical tokamak situation. And now the drift induced velocity is given above, is given above here. And if the thermal particle motion is now given by that velocity component, by ER over B phi, which is roughly B, this situation is then called toroidal resonance. This is what we call toroidal resonance. And for that case, the resonant radial electric field is just by rearranging the equation v parallel times b theta, which then is approximately epsilon b phi iota bar v parallel. So this is the toroidal resonance. If the electric field is strong enough such that the resulting poloidal component of the drift velocity cancels out the thermal poloidal component, where the thermal, sorry, the poloidal component of the thermal motion of the particle. Okay, now the resonant, this toroidal resonance, the electrical resulting or corresponding field, ERES, is critical for the particle confinement. It's critical for the particle confinement, and that is both in stellarator and tokamak. Both in stellarator and tokamak, because now the particles do not make or no longer make a full poloidal turn. They're basically staying at one poloidal angle because their poloidal velocity component which they initially had is cancelled out by this radioelectric field induced drift velocity. And this means that the grad B induced drift, or via the diamagnetic drift as we discussed it, is no longer cancelled out, it's not compensated, which is usually achieved by the twisted magnetic field, right? And this means we get kind of open orbits. These are referred often to as open orbits because they end up at the vessel wall. So we get open orbits similar, where they are not close to the orbits, open orbits similar to the helically trapped particles. And this means direct particle losses can occur. So this is something to be aware of. But this is not the end of the story. So, but the poloidal drift component can have beneficial influence. It can have beneficial influence on helically trapped particles, so in a stellarator, on helically trapped particles occurring in a stellarator, as you know, can be in that sense beneficial for them, helping the particles that they escape, sort of escape their poloidal trapping condition, And we will discuss that in more detail in one of the next videos. So for now, let's look at the basic requirement for that. So the requirement is that the loss time due to the grad B drift is larger than the poloidal transit time. And the poloidal transit time due to the poloidal drift component, ER cross B drift, which we previously have written as UDC. And if we want to write that in a bit more formal way, the loss time due to the grad B drift can be estimated by the minor radius A over the resulting or the corresponding drift velocity. And this should be larger than 2 pi A, so one poloidal circumference, and then B over ER, so over the resulting drift velocity and the inverse of it. And now inserting for the drift velocity the approximation, we have here the temperature, or rather the energy, as you know, Q R naught B. If we insert that, then we find the expression that the radial electric field has to be larger than 2 pi, the energy of the particle, the temperature, over Q R naught. And if this is fulfilled, then helically trapped particles are not lost. Yeah, so this is a very important fact for a stellarator. Having said that, let's now have a look at a stellarator. So this is W7X, color-coded again the magnetic field strength. So let's have a look at this video. So the magnetic field is kind of unfolded here. We only look at one period. And we will see now one particle which is helically trapped, but instead of leaving the confinement region, this helically trapped particle just bounces around. So the resulting radial electric field in the stellarator in W7X leads to a turning around of the particle, which is not lost. So this is a strong enhancement in the performance, or lead to a strong enhancement in the performance. So here you can see it. So this was a simulation for W7X, illustrating how to reduce, or illustrating that we can reduce the loss of helically trapped particles by a radial electric field. And this is then also called an optimized stellarator, because these losses are strongly reduced, which we had in the original stellarator design. Okay, that's it for this video, where we talked about the influence of a radial electric field. We will talk about more how this field is created in one of the next videos. For now, you should have learned that the electric field, of course, can lead to drifts, and this drift can be important if the drift velocity, the poloidal drift velocity component, is the same as the poloidal thermal motion component. Then we speak of a toroidal resonance. Particles can get lost then. In a stellarator, however, the radial electric field can also be beneficial, because it can help to reduce the losses of helically trapped particles, illustrated in this movie here by, for example, turning the motion of the particles basically poloidally around so that they are no longer lost. That's it for this video. Hope to see you in the next video.